Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to an episode of Seek and Destroy, and today we are going to do a review of JLA Avengers, which recently was reprinted by the Hero Initiative, which is a great organization. I highly recommend you check them out. Donate to them if you can. I'll put a link to them down below. Basically, over the years in comic books, there have been a lot of creators out there that haven't made it big, haven't created characters that went on to be, you know, in movies and TV, didn't get residuals, got bad contract deals because a lot of them were freelance and they were work for hire and they just didn't get a lot of the benefits that come with being an actual employee for a company. And so because of that, as they age and get older, they're left with medical bills, all these things that they can't afford. So the Hero Initiative is really great. George Perez is one of the board members, I believe, of it. And they basically reach out to people, get donations, help raise money to help different artists and writers over the years who are in their, you know, maybe twilight years of their life, to pay their bills and stay ahead and prevent from having the stresses of medical bills and rent and other things like that over their heads while they, you know, still try to produce art if they can. And it's really tough. The business of, you know, movie making and comic books and all these things are very unforgiving. Music, you know, not everybody is in the spotlight. And there are a lot of people out there that were in these industries and work really hard at it and don't get that level of recognition or don't get that level of support. And that's what the Hero Initiative does for comic book creators. So please go check them out. I'll put a link again down below. If you can, donate a few dollars to them. And also see, I don't know if you'll be able to find one of these. This is normally, I try not to review things that are really difficult to find. This is really difficult to find, but it's such a big part of our history as comic book fans that I had to make a video on it. And the fact that I was able to get one is just, it means a lot to me. I mean, I literally want to be buried with this thing. This is a real work of art. Kurt Busiek, who wrote it, who's a master and legendary comic book writer, and George Perez, the one and only and the greatest, in my opinion. You know, ever since Teen Titans, I've been a big fan of his, but he did Inhuman stuff for Marvel. He is just amazing. And anyone who knows comic books, you probably know who George Perez is. And if you're new into comics, go do your research, find books that he's drawn. I'm telling you, some of the greatest stuff you will ever see. I promise. They're beautiful. And he's one of those guys that will draw like 400 characters on a splash page, you know? He's kind of like Ivan Reyes was like that during the Green Lantern run Jeff Johns did, where Jeff Johns was like, yeah, I wrote down like 100 characters for him to draw, and he drew 200. And George Perez was like that. If Marv Wolfman was like, hey, I need you to do like, you know, 50 characters on this page, George Perez would throw in like 30 or 40 more characters, you know? That's just who he is. He wants to squeeze as much in each panel and each page as he possibly can. And that is a true artist. He's amazing. And so this book here, where the JLA and Avengers meet, it's not the first time they met in comics, but it is the last. Actually, this came out in the early 2000s, right before Disney bought Marvel and the Warner Brothers Corporation got a little bit more, you know, hands-on with the DC characters. So now that these two, you know, giants are owned by corporations, the odds of them ever crossing over again are slim to none, probably none, most likely. So this kind of officially marks the last time Marvel and DC characters officially, not like variants of them or weird, you know, recent stuff that Jason Aaron did in Avengers where he's kind of like hinting at them, you know, or using Squadron Supreme as a knockoff version of them or whatever. It's not like that. Like, these are literally the characters: Batman, Superman, Captain America, Thor, you know, Wonder Woman, like all in Scarlet Witch, all in the same book. It's just wonderful. And what's really cool is that the heart of the story is the villain, which is Krona, which is a Green Lantern villain who I'm a big, big fan of. So I'll start talking about this. I'm not going to do every spoiler in it, but I am going to talk about some. So if you've never read this, I wish Hero Initiative could release a digital version of Comixology for like $20 and just give all that money to, you know, to where it needs to go. So that way people can read this. It is a shame. They did a very limited number of these and they are hard to get. And it was a miracle that I was able to get one. And I give a big thanks to the people who will, you know, put me in that position where I could get one at regular price that I didn't have to pay, you know, astronomical prices. But they, you know, they wanted to remain nameless, but I want to thank them. They are, it's amazing because I love this book. I've only ever owned the first issue. I've read issues 2, 3, and 4. I borrowed them from a friend back when they first printed them. And I think there was a collection of this before, a hardcover and maybe a softcover, but I never owned them. I never got a chance. So I've only read the book one time in its entirety, but I've read issue one a dozen times. I love the setup for this. Basically, you have the Grandmaster from the Marvel Universe, and you have Metron, one of my favorite characters from the DC Universe, and they're kind of the two brains of each world. And then you have Krona that shows up, and he's going around to different worlds. So the book starts off and you see Earth 3, with all the evil super characters like Ultraman and stuff, and Owlman and Superwoman, I think. And so you have all of them and their worlds being destroyed. And then you have other worlds in the DC Universe getting destroyed. And then you have other Marvel Universe worlds getting destroyed. And you find out that it's Krona. Krona is still on his mission, right? His mission was always to see. If you follow the lore of the Marvel and DC Universes, in Marvel, at the beginning of time, there was a voice that spoke. And Galactus, before he became Galactus, heard that voice. He was someone that existed before that voice showed up. And I guess so did Null now, too, if you want to add Null to the mix. But at this point, Null didn't exist for you Venom fans. So you have Galactus, who kind of heard the voice. And then in the DC Universe, you have this blue hand that showed up at the beginning where the Big Bang was and opened up the universe and thus created the DC Universe. So Krona has this thing that inside of him that just wants answers. He wants to know where they come from. He wants to know what happened before the Big Bang. He wants to know who that blue hand belongs to, which if you read Doomsday Clock recently, you find out that it's kind of strongly hinted at being Dr. Manhattan from the Watchmen universe, and that he helped create these, he found this, a DC universe and started rewriting it over and over and over, hence all the reboots that the universe has gotten over the years. So I kind of like that explanation too, but here Krona wants to find out that answer. He wants to know what time was like before the Big Bang and where maybe they all come from. So that's what Krona's mission is. He's one of the guardians of the universe, like the Green Lantern. They have the guardians, the round table of them, Ali Abliapsa, and some of the other characters, Ganthet and stuff. And Sade. So that's what Krona is, and he wants to find out what it is, what the answer is, and he can't. So he's going around destroying all these universes, trying to find the answer. And along the way, he comes across the Marvel Universe and finds Grandmaster, who then, cons him into playing a game, because that's what the Grandmaster does, right? Played by Jeff Goldblum, I think he played the Grandmaster in the Guardians of the Galaxy. No, in Thor Ragnarok, yeah. So it's that character. And he cons Krona into playing a game. And he says, look, let's take these two worlds, because he already talked to Metron at this point. And he's like, but Krona doesn't know that. And he's like, all right, let's take these two worlds and let's have them fight, basically. And then whoever, their mission is, there's six objects from each world that are very powerful. So we'll put the Marvel characters in the DC universe and they got to find those six items. And the DC characters in the Marvel universe and they got to find those six items. And whoever wins, that universe gets to live or whatever. And so that's the setup for the story. So along the way, you just have all these really great moments with all these really great characters. There's Grandmaster there with the items, checking out. You have Batman and, talking to Martian Manhunter. The Watcher shows up at one point to talk to, or not talk, actually just shows up to watch the Watchtower, which I thought was really cool. And Flash, who is not Barry Allen, because Barry Allen is dead at this point, and so is Hal Jordan. So the Flash is Wally West, Barry's former sidekick. And Kyle Rayner is the Green Lantern in this storyline. So I really like that because it's very much in keeping with when this book came out in the early 2000s. But there's a great moment in the story where Hal Jordan and Barry both get resurrected temporarily to be the Green Lantern and Flash because the realities are being rewritten. And they have this great heart-to-heart conversation where they say, Hal's like, hey, Barry, I got to meet your predecessor, Wally West, and he's amazing. Like, you left behind a great legacy. And then Barry says, I met Kyle and I worked with him on a mission during all this craziness. And you too left behind a good legacy. Like, he goes, but there is still redemption in you. I know it. He goes, because you're not gone. He's now the Spectre. And he's like, but I believe, maybe it's good that we're gone because we have people still fighting the good fight for us. So there was a lot of really good character moments in here that Kurt Busiek squeezed in, which I really loved. And then these great moments where the Justice League show up on Monster Island and have to battle the monsters of the Marvel Universe. There's just so many things that they squeeze in here. One thing they definitely do is Superman starts acting erratic. He's upset that this world, because he compares the Marvel and DC universe. He's like, in our world, everyone worships us. We're heroes. We always save them. In the Marvel universe, people are divided on them. It's more of a realistic world, right? So there's people that are split on whether, the Captain America is really standing for true justice in the American way or not, And I that's just neat because that's how I've always known the DC universe. That's why every time these, filmmakers come out and say, oh, we want to make a realistic, more grounded DC universe. I'm like, but that's never been the case in the comic books. Their world is very different than the Marvel universe. Marvel has always been kind of grounded. It's the world right outside your window. DC is not. And so I love the comparisons Kurt Busiek does here, where he explains that the Marvel universe planet itself is actually smaller than the DC planet, because the DC planet has cities on it that don't exist in our world. So it's a bigger planet, just inherently bigger. So, but they also say, Superman mentions, well, because our planet's bigger, we can spread out poverty and things like that more because our planet's bigger. Here, poverty is more condensed, into single areas that make crime, high, or and there's dirty politician stuff. Not that they don't have it in their universe, but when they do, it's like Lex Luthor, and they know he's a bad guy. So it's just really neat. It was just really cool conversation between Superman, Captain America, Batman, all these characters comparing their worlds. But then also getting some really good fights along the way, and the Avengers showing up in the DC universe and fighting, like the Royal Flush Gang and other people. There's this one really great moment where the Justice League first appear in the Marvel universe, and they're going around stopping, or they're going around just observing crime and heroes in action, and they're just processing it. They're like, all right, we're all invisible. We're just kind of watching it happen. Nobody interject. And then they come across New York City, and Batman sees the Punisher, like shooting people, like with guns and everything. And off panel, you don't even see the fight. Batman goes and kicks the living crap out of the Punisher, and you don't even see the fight. It just cuts to everyone going, Batman, like, you told us not to intervene, and you were the one to intervene. And he's like, yeah. He goes, well, the guy had guns. And they're like, we're not here for that. We're not, we're here to just find these items and save our universe. And he goes, what happens in this world is theirs. And Batman's like, yeah, well, this guy was killing a lot of people. So I just thought that was great that Batman saw the Punisher and was like, nah, and then just went and beat the crap out of him. Because I like those crossovers from the 90s. They did two versions of Batman and Punisher. And I think they would go toe-to-toe pretty well. But it was just neat that in this one, Kurt Busiek was like, nah, Batman took down Punisher, no problem. So I thought it was fun. But you have a lot of great, like I said, just super amazing moments. George's art, fantastic. The Justice League meeting the Avengers, them realizing that they're on this shared mission, and then exchanging blows, where the first blow is Superman getting hit with Thor's hammer, and that starts it off. And what's really cool is that moment comes back later when Superman actually picks up Thor's hammer. Let me see if I can find that. And meanwhile, while that's all happening, Krona is out there, pursuing his mission, but also playing this game now. But then once the game accelerates and the heroes start finding all the pieces, Batman and Captain America square off, and they're like getting ready to fight each other. And they throw a couple blows, but each one blocks the other one. And then finally they go, Captain America goes, look, we're not going to beat each other. He's like, it looks like every move you make, I anticipate, and same and vice versa. And he goes, I've been acting erratic lately. It's not me. I'm aware of it now that it's not me. That's not who I am. So I think our strings are being pulled. Why don't me and you, while the big battle's happening, go figure out some answers? And they take the atom and they send the atom onto Metron's chair, and he goes off and gets answers from through Metron, who doesn't know he's there, or maybe doesn't know he's there, maybe he does, and the Grand Master, and he starts figuring out the big plot. That's what Atom is doing, which I really loved. And then meanwhile, Batman and Captain America are working on a ground level to figure out what's going on, and they figure out that if the Marvel Universe wins, both worlds are destroyed. So Batman and Captain America, they convince their teammates to allow the DC characters to win. So the DC characters get 7 of the 12 artifacts, and leaving only 5 to Marvel. So at first they were neck and neck. It was like a close race. And it looks like it was going to be an even tie, but then the Justice League got ahead. But that's because they needed to, so that both worlds could survive, because that was the bet Grandmaster made. And then Krona reneges on the bet and says, no. I'm going to just destroy all of you now and just find another world that could have answers. And Grandmaster's like, no, there's someone in my universe that does have answers. His name is Galactus. He was there before the beginning. So maybe if you find him, you'll get them and spare these worlds. And he's like, no. And so he goes to attack them. And that's when the Grandmaster uses the 12 artifacts to fight back against Krona and trap him between the two worlds. So issues 3 and 4 are the worlds merging and not really becoming an amalgam universe like it did in the 90s, but just merging, and all the characters' histories are being shared and they're swapping out. So there's times where like Black Canary is kissing, Oliver Queen, Green Arrow. And then the next scene, Oliver Queen is now Hawkeye, because now their timelines are merging and it's screwing everything up. So that whole third issue was kind of wacky and fun, because it's just them doing that. And that issue starts off with the two universe characters like embracing and kissing, which I thought was really funny. But this is Krona mixing the two worlds together. And so that's when Iron Man and Superman realize that, and they go, okay, we got to fight back. And then this is the cover of Superman taking Captain America's shield and lifting Thor's hammer, which in the book is so amazing, because that's, in the end, they realize they have to work together to stop Krona, and the Grandmaster is dying and Metron is, enigmatically trying to help them along with the Phantom Stranger. And so the heroes all kind of band together and say, okay, we need to fight, but we need to pick a leader. And they all look to Superman, and Superman, in a very Superman way too, says, no, I'm not the leader. He is. And he points at Captain America and he's like, he's going to lead us. He's tactical. He's smart. He's capable of doing this. Put him in the watchtower. And he says, Martian Manhunter, link his brain to all of ours. So when he has a thought on how to counteract an attack, we all know what it is instantly and we can do it. And then so Captain America says, well, if I'm going to be the leader and you're going into battle, as powerful as you are, you're going to be up against some magic, which weakens you. That, they find that out in the story. So he gives Superman his shield and he says, use this. It'll protect you. And so Superman is rocking Captain America's shield and going into battle, which was so awesome. I kind of wish he gave it to Wonder Woman, but it was a symbolic gesture, which I thought was really good, because the only reason I kind of wish he gave it to Wonder Woman is because Wonder Woman does carry a shield sometimes. So it would have been cool to see her have it, but she's not like pledged to America in that way. She's kind of a liaison between worlds, different foreign, countries and stuff, like with Themyscira and the rest of the world. So she's kind of a UN type superhero, whereas Superman does kind of represent the heart of what America is in a lot of ways. So I did like the gesture, but there is a point later on where, because Thor and Superman are kind of at each other's throats through most of the story, and then they realize their attitudes are being enhanced by the worlds merging, and that's why they've been acting out of character. So there's a point in the story where Thor throws the hammer to Superman, and Superman grabs it, and he's able to use it and fight back against Krona and all these villains. It's so awesome. There's just so many good moments in here. While Flash is running on the cosmic treadmill, trying to create a vibration to separate the worlds, which he's like, hey, look, Barry did this once, to kind of unite the multiverse in a way. Now, at the end of it, he goes, I'm using it to like recreate the multiverse and push everything back. Just so many good moments, just so many good fights. Metron showing up at, near the end, Grandmaster being resurrected, and all of them just trying to help these heroes fight. I mean, Captain America turns into US agent at one point, because like I said, it just goes through their timeline. So you have Hal show up, you have Barry show up, even after their deaths. But then as everyone's, fighting, battling, you got heroes versus villains from different universes. Big Barda, I love, she has a little moment in there. Captain Marvel, who I think is known as Warbird at that time. Superman shows up as an electric Superman during a fight with Thor, who looks like a 90s Thor. So just a lot of wacky, fun, over-the-top moments. But then you get Krona, who, like I said, is a Green Lantern villain, and he looks like he's going to win. But then right as the heroes are fighting him and they start taking him down with Scarlet Witch, whose powers are super enhanced, and Vision, and they're like mourning because everyone gets to see their life. They're like, all right, what are we saving? They talk to the Grandmaster and they go, we want to save our worlds, but we don't remember our worlds that much because everything's merging and we're forgetting. So please show us our worlds. So Vision and Wanda see that they had kids that are now gone. And they're like, well, we don't want to save a world where we don't have our kids in it. And then you have like, Hank, Hank Pym, who hit Janet, his wife, Wasp. There was a point in the comics where he like turned and slapped her. And I guess, I don't know, some say it was unintentional, some say it was. There's a big divisive argument over that. But either way, it happened. And so when Hank relives that moment, he's like, it's the biggest regret of his life. And he looks at Jan and he's like, I'm sorry. Like, I literally was... that it wasn't me. And he goes, but I don't want to save a world where I did that to you. But then they're like, yeah, but look at all the other good things that happen. Look at all the lives we save. Look at all this. Like, these things have to happen, good or bad. Your life is your life. Continuity is continuity. And you got to just make it work and process it, you know, whether you love it or not, and whether it represents a good side of you or not. And it just was, it was, I don't know, it was a really great moment. So at the end, when they're facing all that and they take down Krona, the worlds are still merging and they don't know how to stop it. And like I said, Krona's a Green Lantern villain. So who better to show up to fix his mess than a Green Lantern? You have Hal Jordan, the Spectre, arriving to separate the worlds and help push them back to where they go, along with the help of the heroes. Just awesome. This book is great. And then there are the two universes from Marvel and DC who were embracing each other and now separating. And what I really loved is each one of these books was called something that was like a nod to like really classic Marvel and DC books, like Journey into Mystery and Strange Adventures and The Brave and the Bold. The last issue is called The Brave and the Bold. Just so cool. Just really a love letter in a lot of ways to both Marvel and DC. And to show you that you don't have to pick one over the other. Like, yes, I'm more of a DC fan because I like the characters more and I like the world more, but I love the Marvel characters also. To me, it's they're neck and neck. They're so close. And if I do like DC a little bit more, it's a little bit more. But this book, to me, is just a wonderful love letter to both. And I think no matter if you're a Marvel fan and you read this, you're still going to love the Marvel characters at the end of this. That doesn't weaken them. It doesn't show them in a non-iconic light. And same with the DC characters. If you come in reading this as a DC fan, everybody gets a moment, heroes and villains. It's really, really fun. Spider-Man shows up a couple times. I think the Fantastic Four, Ben Grimm gets a really great moment with Batman and Captain America. So good. I mean, there's so many moments in this that are just epic and legendary. And sadly, probably the last time we'll ever see it. So if you're able to find the single issues of this or previous printed copies of it, or if you're able to get this one, it's worth it because it's a piece of our history. You know, it for those of us who love comic books as much as I do, and some of you who love it more than I do, and some of you who are just getting into it, this is a part of that history. And it's created and drawn and written by some of the best talents we've ever had in comic books. So if you can track it down, please do. It's amazing. It's worth every penny you probably spend on it. And also, you know, if you do buy it online from like a second seller, you know, try to still donate a few dollars to, you know, the seller themselves if you can. If you're charging like $200 on eBay for this, try at least give like $100 of that to the Hero Initiative, you know, after you sell it, because then you're still making your profit, I guess, if that's what you're out to do. But at least you're also helping the cause that this book exists for. That's more important. So if you can, if you're out there and you're selling a copy of this, you know, if you're selling it for a high price, just take a large chunk of that high price and give it to where it needs to go. Give it to George, give it to Hero Initiative. And again, I'll put a link to that down below. And if you buy a copy and you get it at a reasonable price, maybe throw a few extra bucks to the Hero Initiative, just as a thank you for them for letting us see this and getting this book out in the light of day one more time. Hopefully it's not the last time we see it. I would love for everybody in the world who is a comic book fan to read this book. But if that's not a reality, then maybe, you know, just me making this video and talking about it and you watching other YouTubers talk about it, hopefully that's enough for now. And maybe one day, again, we'll get to see this book. So thank you so much for watching the episode. If you've read this book or not, let me know your comments down below. I'd love to hear them. And as always, we'll continue our conversation down there. See you all in the future. Peace.